In numerous debates and writings, Christian apologist Dinesh D'Souza has expressed his opinion that Christianity is responsible for the abolition of slavery in the Western world. While there were certainly Christians who participated in the abolitionist movement and took inspiration from their faith, it cannot be ignored that there were many Christians who interpreted the scriptures in just the opposite manner, to endorse slavery. To credit Christianity with ending slavery is frankly absurd. As it will be shown, Christianity has a history of supporting racism and slavery, long before the United States of America even existed. Genesis 9:20-27 was used as the justification for racism and slavery for many centuries. The passage describes what is commonly called the curse of Ham. Ham was a son of Noah who walked in and saw his father passed out naked after a night of drinking. When Noah awoke, he cursed Ham's youngest son Canaan, saying, "Cursed be Canaan, the lowest of slaves will he be to his brothers." Ham is typically identified as the forefather of the southern regions of Africa, and the Bible refers to Egypt as the land of Ham. The Talmud reads that three copulated in the ark, and they were all punished, the dog, the raven, and Ham. The dog was doomed to be tied, the raven expectorates his seed into his mate's mouth, and Ham was smitten in his skin. According to many ancient biblical commentaries, the curse of Ham was placed on a race of dark-skinned people. The 2nd century church father Origen echoes this sentiment in his homilies on Genesis. "For the Egyptians are prone to a degenerate life and quickly sink to every slavery of the vices. Look at the origin of the race and you will discover that their father, Ham, who had laughed at his father's nakedness, deserved a judgment of this kind, that his son Canaan should be a servant to his brothers, in which case the condition of bondage would prove the wickedness of his conduct. Not without merit, therefore, does the discolored posterity imitate the ignobility of the race." Ephraim the Syrian, a 4th century Christian theologian, explained that when Noah awoke and was told what Canaan did, Noah said, "Cursed be Canaan, may God make his face black," and immediately the face of Canaan changed. So did of his father Ham, and their white faces became black and dark, and their color changed. And Catherine Emmerich, who was beatified by John Paul II in 2004, remarked, "I saw the curse pronounced by Noah upon Ham moving toward the latter like a black cloud and obscuring him. His skin lost its whiteness, he grew darker. His sin was the sin of sacrilege, the sin of one who would forcibly enter the Ark of the Covenant. I saw a most corrupt race descend from Ham and sink deeper and deeper in darkness. I see that the black, idolatrous, stupid nations are the descendants of Ham. Their color is due, not to the rays of the sun, but to the dark source whence those degraded races sprang." The Bible doesn't directly associate the curse of Ham with skin color, but many Christians have interpreted it in just that way. The curse of Ham is also not the only justification for slavery that Christians found. St. Thomas Aquinas, the renowned 13th century theologian and philosopher, states in his Summa Theologica that slavery among men is natural, for some are naturally slaves according to the philosopher. Now slavery belongs to the right of nations, as Isidore states. Therefore, the right of nations is a natural right. George Whitefield was the man who brought the Great Awakening and revivalism from Britain to America in the mid-18th century. However, when slavery was outlawed in Georgia, this spiritual leader fought to have it legalized, ultimately succeeding in 1851. In the 19th century, Reverend Richard Furman argued that the right of holding slaves is clearly established by the Holy Scriptures, both by precept and example. In the Old Testament, the Israelites were directed to purchase their bondmen and bondmaids of the heathen nations, except they were of the Canaanites, for these were to be destroyed. And it is declared that the persons purchased were to be their bondmen forever, and an inheritance for them and their children. He goes on to say, "In the New Testament, the gospel history or representation of facts presents us a view correspondent with that which is furnished by other authentic ancient histories of the state of the world at the commencement of Christianity. The powerful Romans had succeeded in empire the polished Greeks, and under both empires the countries they had possessed and governed were full of slaves. Many of these, with their masters, were converted to the Christian faith and received together with them into the Christian church, while it was yet under the ministry of the inspired apostles. In things purely spiritual, they appear to have enjoyed equal privileges, but their relationship as masters and slaves was not dissolved. Their respective duties are strictly enjoined." Also from the 19th century, George Fitzhugh wrote that, "If we prove that domestic slavery is, in the general, a natural and necessary institution, we remove the greatest stumbling block to belief in the Bible. For whilst text, detached and torn from their context, may be found for any other purpose, none can be found that even militates against slavery. The distorted and forced construction of certain passages for this purpose by abolitionists, if employed as a common rule of construction, would reduce the Bible to a mere allegory, to be interpreted to suit every vicious taste and wicked purpose. Of course, Bible-inspired racism was not only directed at Africans. Even though the Christian Bible contains the history of the Jewish people in the Old Testament, and despite the portrayal of Jesus as a Jewish teacher in all the Gospels, many people found support for anti-Semitism from Christianity as well. Under Constantine, Christians were prohibited from converting to Judaism, while the Theodosian and Justinian codes stripped Jews of their civil rights. They could not testify against Christians, nor could they hold public office. However, it wasn't only the Catholic Church that oppressed the Jews. The Protestant reformer himself, Martin Luther, authored a text called Against the Jews and Their Lies. What then shall we Christians do with this damned, rejected race of Jews? Let me give you my honest advice. First, their synagogues or churches should be set on fire. Secondly, their homes should likewise be broken down and destroyed. Thirdly, they should be deprived of their prayer books. Justin Martyr, the second century church father, wrote of Jews, "The custom of circumcising the flesh, handed down from Abraham, was given to you as a distinguishing mark, to set you off from other nations and from us Christians. The purpose of this was that you, and only you, might suffer the afflictions that are now justly yours, that only your land be desolated and your cities ruined by fire, that the fruits of your land be eaten by strangers before your very eyes, that not one of you be permitted to enter your city of Jerusalem." 4th century church father John Chrysostom also railed on the Jews in several of his sermons. "The synagogue is worse than a brothel. It is the den of scoundrels and the repair of wild beasts, the temple of demons devoted to idolatrous cults, the refuge of brigands and debauchees, and the cavern of devils. It is a criminal assembly of Jews, a place of meeting for the assassins of Christ, a house worse than a drinking shop, a den of thieves, a house of ill fame, a dwelling of iniquity, the refuge of devils, a gulf and an abyss of perdition." It has also been well documented and discussed in numerous other videos that the Nazi Party in Germany had fairly clear affiliations with Christianity. From Christian iconography adorning the party propaganda, to churches aiding in the message, and even the words of Hitler himself. "My feelings as a Christian points me to my Lord and Savior as a fighter. It points me to the man who once in loneliness, surrounded by a few followers, recognized these Jews for what they were and summoned men to fight against them, and who, God's truth, was greatest not as a sufferer, but as a fighter. In boundless love, as a Christian and as a man, I read through the passage which tells us how the Lord at last rose in his might and seized the scourge to drive out of the temple the brood of vipers and adders. How terrific was his fight for the world against the Jewish poison. Today, after 2,000 years, with deepest emotion, I recognize more profoundly than ever before the fact that it was for this that he had to shed his blood upon the cross. As a Christian, I have no duty to allow myself to be cheated, but I have the duty to be a fighter for truth and justice. And if there is anything which could demonstrate that we are acting rightly, it is the distress that daily grows. For as a Christian, I have also a duty to my own people." Were these men all misguided in their interpretations of the Bible as modern Christians would have us believe? Stay tuned for part 2, where we will dive into the text of the Bible itself to determine what else it says on the issues of slavery and anti-Semitism.